How to grow back bald edges fast. Does castor oil actually work? Should we be taking biotin? Is oiling the scalp good for the hair or nah? Listen, y'all, we talk about skin a lot on this channel, and we're gonna be talking about the scalp today. There's a lot of misconceptions out there, folks just swindling you left and right, to and fro. Joining me today is... Joining me today, dropping truth bombs all up and through this video, is Dr. Crystal AGUH. She's a board-certified dermatologist at Johns Hopkins. She's also the author of several books, 90 Days to Beautiful Hair, as well as a free ebook, which I will link in the description box, which you can check that out. She's also an NIH, Skin of Color Society, and DF, alopecia-supported researcher. That basically means that she knows what she's talking about. Now, you're gonna wanna take some notes, get to jotting, because there's gonna be a lot of information here, and I want you to be able to refer back to your notes as well as refer back to this video, because a lot of stuff in here is gonna blow your mind, especially the part about the biotin. I saw a lot of videos where they were like, how to grow back bald edges fast. Yep. From your professional perspective, what actually happens when we lose our edges?
Losing your edges, the medical term for that is traction alopecia, and it really appears in three stages, okay? Stage one is you put in some form of extensions, right? Or maybe a tight ponytail, it's a wig, weave, braids, whatever it may be. You take it out and you're like, ooh, my edges are a little thin. You take a break, maybe use a little castor oil, and it just pops right back, right? You're just like, oh, I just needed a little break, okay? That's stage one. People are not coming to the dermatologist for stage one disease, right? Because they understand what took it out, it comes right back. People are really coming in stage two, stage three. So this is over time, you've been doing extensions. The amount of time it takes to get to stage two is different, right? Someone who has very fine hair is going to progress to stage two, faster than someone who has very thick hair, right? But stage two is the point where you take the extensions out, you've given it a break, and it's not coming back. So I have a lot of patients, they'll come to me and they'll say, I don't know what the cause is because I haven't done extensions, relaxers, anything for 5 years. Well, stage two only responds to medical therapy. Then I'll say, well, what were you doing 5 years ago? Right? I was in braids all the time. That was my go-to. I always ask people, what's your go-to? Right? What is, because we all have like a hairstyle look that people associate with us. But at that stage, we can apply something like minoxidil, but you need a true medicine and it can restore maybe 40 to 60% of what is lost, which can be adequate and be amazing. Stage three is when, again, you've been out of extensions or maybe you're still in extensions and now the scalp is feeling smooth. Okay. Now you're feeling around your scalp, it's feeling smooth. And if you were to do medical therapy, it actually would not grow in at all. The only thing that will fix that is a hair transplant, okay? Where you literally have to take hair from the back of your scalp and move it up front. So when I see advertisements for growing back bald edges, a lot of that is misleading, right? People show inaccurate pictures, but you can grow back edges with oils and things like that if you're in stage one disease, right? It's very limited, it's very minor, it's just a little bit thin. But for women who have very severe, like you're just like, oh my gosh, right? It's so bad that they would have to cover it up. That will not respond to any oil.
When people are in that stage one phase where they're like, okay, I went a little too tight last time. Right. She braided me up, too tightly. What can we do at home? And do things like castor oil really work?
I think of castor oil as low risk with some potential reward. There are a few oils that may help stimulate hair regrowth. There's not like there's data behind it, but there's enough conversation about it that they may work. So castor oil is one, rosemary oil, peppermint oil is another, lavender. Sometimes I will give my patients a recipe of essential oil, an essential oil mixture that they can try that's been studied in a medical journal before. And so those are things that are appropriate to try. And I think those are fine to try at home first, especially if you've already decided stopping the hair practices. So if you had a set of braids that you were like, oh my God, I went to a braider who was just too aggressive. Look at my edges. Well, then make sure you don't go back to that braider, right? And then say, well, I'm gonna go back, but now I'm gonna put in castor oil. Well, no, take a break. Give your edges time to relax, try some of these oils, and if they work, then that's great. And then just know that you have to be gentle moving forward.
When people get to this stage two point where they're like, okay, nothing's coming back, what happens when they come into your office?
So most of my stage two patients, which fortunately, I still run about 50-50, but slightly more of my patients are in stage two disease. I'll give them two options. If it's stage two, but it's still like limited, I'll tell them to use over-the-counter minoxidil, and I'll tell them to get the men's box, because the men's box is the exact same strength as the woman's, but I'll tell them to use it once a day, whereas men are told to use it twice a day. And you can get a 6-month supply of the men's for about $40, but you're only using half the amount. So that's really will last you 12 months, okay? Mm. Now realize, if your scalp has already decided that it's only going to respond to medical therapy, let's say you start using it and you're like, oh, this is amazing. Finally, this is what I'm used to. Well, you have to keep using it to keep it, right? If you stop the minoxidil, then it's all going to fall out, because those follicles have already decided that they require constant stimulation. It's kind of like watering a plant, right? You water a plant every day for 6 months. It's looking lush. You forget to water for 3 months, it's not going to remember what you did the first 6 months, right? It's going to die, right? And that can be hard for a lot of women to come to terms with, because they're just like, God, but you don't understand. Like, I used to not have a problem with this. Now you're telling me I have to use something every day. Well, any medicine, once you require medical treatment for anything, whether we're treating traction alopecia or we're treating high blood pressure or diabetes, right? With high blood pressure, you have a point where you could just change your diet. But once you got to go on a medication, you got to go on a medication. I am not a huge fan of the formulations that are available over the counter, because I think for Black hair, they can be very drying and damaging. And so very often I will actually formulate minoxidil in higher strengths in oils and ointments that are more compatible with Black hair. And those are more costly. Those will run patients about $60 or so for about a 2-month supply. But again, they are much more potent. And I'm really trying to give patients the best chance of responding before they have to even consider things like hair transplants. For stage two disease, additionally, platelet-rich plasma therapy is an option. Platelet-rich plasma therapy is a cosmetic treatment where we take your own blood, we spin it down in a centrifuge, and we separate the blood into a red part and a yellow part. That yellow part is the plasma. We inject that back into the scalp. It can be quite effective for traction alopecia. That's gonna run you, you know, no matter where you are in the country, that's gonna run you between $2,000 and $5,000 for a full treatment course, which usually consists of about 3 treatments, and it has to be repeated yearly. So again, if you do the platelet-rich plasma and you're like, this is great, I love my hair, more often than not, you're gonna have to come back in a year when it starts to go away and get another set of treatments.
And for anyone that has to go as far as a hair transplant, what does that process look like, and how much approximately does it cost?
Yeah, so if we've done things like medical therapy, we've done platelet-rich plasma, and it's still just like we're not getting the restoration that we'd like to see, then hair transplant's excellent. And I like to tell my patients that Black women tend to have the best aesthetic outcomes out of any group. Curly hair tends to transplant very, very nicely. And it is not visible at all. So there's no like surgical scar where people will say like, oh, what's that, right? So it's really seamless. And it is an all day procedure. So it takes about 8 hours to do a hair transplant. It's gonna run you about $10,000 to $20,000, depending on how much area has to be transplanted. That's gonna vary based on how much hair loss you have, how long you've had it. But the nice thing about this is it's a permanent treatment. So it's not something that you have to repeat, as long as you're not subjecting your scalp to the same type of tension, then you would be able to do this procedure once and would experience kind of lifelong hair restoration in that area. So it is a really excellent option.
Biotin.
Yes.
Is biotin, do we actually need biotin? What are your thoughts on biotin?
Yeah, great. I hate biotin. So, you know, I always tell people biotin has the best PR agent in all of medicine, because everyone, before they come and see me, has tried biotin. It's actually never, ever, not even once been shown to help with any hair characteristic at all. And so it doesn't work. It doesn't work to grow hair. It probably doesn't work to even make your hair stronger. But the big downside about biotin is that it affects your lab work. So there's actually an FDA warning against the use of biotin after there were deaths reported. The death that pushed the FDA over the line was a woman went to the emergency room with chest pain. And there's one lab that every doctor checks if someone has chest pain, and it's called a troponin level, right? And that's literally breakdown of heart tissue. And so she comes in and she's like, oh my God, I have so much chest pain. They check her troponin levels and they're normal. And they're like, well, we know you're not having a heart attack. So we don't know why you're having so much chest pain. They let her go. She passes away from a heart attack because a lot of labs that we run are dependent on a biotin enzyme. And if you're taking biotin, it makes the lab work inaccurate. Another lab that's often affected is your thyroid levels, right? So women have hair loss and they're just like, well, you know, my doctor checked my thyroid levels and my thyroid levels are fine, but they're not telling their doctor that they're on biotin, or maybe it's just not popping up in the system. And it looks like their thyroid levels are normal when in fact they're abnormal. So you actually have to take at least a week off of biotin before you get any lab work done. So coupled with the fact that it doesn't really help with any hair issues, we really just discourage its use. Also for even essential oils, you know, eucalyptus oil and camphor are leading causes of first-time seizures in patients. Right. And so we think about these things and we're just like, oh, this is so harmless. Tea tree oil can cause precocious puberty in young girls, and it causes men to develop breasts. So, you know, there's so many things that are available over the counter and we're like, oh, like I got it from my grocery store. So like, I know it's safe. And yeah, we have to remember that over the counter supplements, none of these things are regulated the way that prescription drugs are regulated, because they're actually all considered food by the FDA. So an essential oil is considered food, a hair growth supplement is considered food, so they don't run a check on it at all, right? And so you just really have to be mindful of some of these risk factors as you're reaching for things over the counter. It doesn't mean that they're necessarily safe. It just means that they are natural, right? But cocaine's also natural.
Should we be oiling our scalps when we have dandruff?
Anywhere else that your body starts to flake or scale generally means that it is dry, okay? So it makes sense to like oil or moisturize. The scalp is literally the one exception. So dandruff is actually a reaction, your scalp's reaction to normal yeast that lives on the scalp. So we all have yeast on the scalp, but some people, their scalp kind of hates it and they start to develop flaking. Now the yeast, what they love is they love the oil of our scalp. So they're like, I'm setting up shop here. This is great. There's a lot of sweat glands here. And so when you're adding oils, you actually can be feeding the yeast, okay? Mm. And so you should not oil your scalp. The way that we treat dandruff is we treat it through one of two ways. We either treat the inflammatory reaction, because that's, you know, when we do that with like a topical steroid, or we can get rid of the yeast with an antifungal. For Black women in particular, this is Black women solely have this unique consideration, not even Black men, because Black women, especially those with longer hair, which is gonna be most of us, most anti-yeast preparations are in the form of shampoos. And for them to work, you have to use them almost every day. And there's no way that anyone with curly hair should be washing their hair with a harsh shampoo every day. And so in my clinic, I almost always will prefer to treat the inflammatory reaction, because I can give you a scalp oil with a steroid that's going to be compatible with curly hair. For my Caucasian patients, Asian, my Black men, I can always do an antifungal shampoo, no problem, right? Because they can run their hair underneath the water every day. But once people start to have more hair, then you really have to avoid those options.
Are there specific oils that we can use on our hair? Because I heard you mention a scalp oil with a steroid in it. Is that what's the difference between that and like what people may be using at home?
Yeah, so what happens is that people are overusing oils because they think their scalp is dry. And so that's not a treatment, right? And so sometimes they're like, well, I keep putting it on and it's just getting worse, but you're not actually treating it. The scalp oil is medicated with a steroid. So the active ingredient is a steroid, and so that is how it gets rid of the inflammatory reaction. And so you just have to at least treat the inflammation, or you have to treat the yeast. But if you're just putting oil and you're just layering your scalp with more oil, it's actually not going to get any better.
Okay, so the difference between carrier oils and essential oils.
I really love carrier oils, and people will think about oils that lead to hair growth, when really for a lot of women, the issue is not hair growth, it's length retention, okay? Essential oils, the ones I mentioned earlier, rosemary, lavender, castor oil, maybe those things, possibly if you put them on a scalp, maybe you'll see some improvement, but the real deal is carrier oils. And these are super important to any hair care regimen if your hair is curly, because basically carrier oils are going to be really fatty. And what they can do is when the hair is already damp, they're going to do a great job of trapping moisture. And so the hair is less likely to break. What I see an issue with is people will get things mixed up. They will apply something like rosemary oil to the length of their hair every day. And they're just like, it's supposed to grow my hair. Why does my hair keep breaking? Well, one, you never want to put oil on dry hair ever, 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 because that's just going to make it even more dry. Two, something like an essential oil, if it's meant to have a medicinal activity, has to go on scalp, right? Scalp is the only living part of this equation, right? So those are never meant to go on the hair. Tea tree oil is never meant to go on your hair. Pepper oil is never, all of those things are meant to go on your scalp if you use them. Things that you should use on the length of your hair are things like grapeseed oil, jojoba oil, avocado oil. Those are things that are actually going to be beneficial in the long run and really, really, really enhance length retention. Because what's the point of growing hair faster if it just breaks off every day anyway, because it's so dry and so thirsty? So I always tell patients, I'd rather you, if you had to pick one, essential oils or carrier oils, I'd rather you pick carrier oils and just have a great understanding of them. And then the last oil that I think people often use incorrectly is coconut oil. Coconut oil is actually almost like a protein treatment, right? So this is why some people use coconut oil and they're like, my hair feels like straw. Because coconut oil actually has the very unique ability to increase the strength of the hair. But you cannot lather coconut oil on dry hair every day. It's actually best as a pre-wash or post-wash treatment. So you put it on pre-wash, it protects your hair from damage and swelling from the shampooing. You put it on post-wash while the hair is still a little bit damp, and it's like a protein treatment and increases strength throughout the week. But there really is a lot of, I think, misunderstanding about how to use oils, because you have to really be very specific about the order that oils apply and what type of oils that you're including in your regimen.
Listen, man, I told y'all, right? For more information on Dr. Agu's course, her book, the ebook, all that information, I will leave that in the description box. You can follow her on Instagram and Twitter. Highly recommend. Every time I hear Dr. Agu speak, I'm like, I don't even have the book open. I'm trying to write notes already. Like, I'm telling you. And that said, drop a comment below. Let me know what was the most eye-opening, the most mind-boggling aha moments that you got from this video. Make sure you share this video too, because this is important information that needs to be spread amongst our community. Follow me on social. I'm on TikTok, Facebook, Instagram. Follow your girl, because when I'm not here, I'm over there. And I'll see you fine folks in my next video. Bye, guys.